Hello, you are mostly welcome to my channel Academic Research. In today's video, I will discuss some more interview questions and answers for electrical and electronics students. So the first question is, why transmission line possesses inductance? So already we know that the transmission line having both inductance and capacitance, but it is very clear that the capacitance is caused in between two phases and one phase and ground, but inductance is present due to what cause? So now let us see the property of a circuit which opposes change in current is called inductance. Already you know that the self-inductance of one coil, that is, it always opposes any change in current. When current increases or decreases, in both cases, the inductance opposes. So as the transmission line carry changing current, that is alternating current, because we are transmitting only alternating current, not the DC current. So as the transmission line carry changing current, they possess inductance. It means what? It means the property of an inductance to oppose any change in current. So as the changing current is supplied in the transmission line, therefore obviously the transmission line having the or possesses inductance. So next question, what is called insulator pollution? Insulator pollution means what? So already we know that air pollution, sound pollution, then water pollution, but the insulator pollution hardly we are listening, but it is practically true, because dust, acids, salts and other pollutants on the atmosphere settle on the insulator. So this reduces insulation resistance, and there is a chance of short circuit occur due to insulator pollution. Therefore, insulator pollution is very, very important factor which affects on the insulation resistance. So when insulation resistance increases, then what happens? Generally, when insulation resistance increases, insulation resistance decreases, leakage current increases, and there is a chance of short circuit occurs. Therefore, insulation resistance should be very high for longevity of any electrical device. So therefore, the insulator pollution mainly affects on the insulation resistance. So the next question is, explain the role of line and ground capacitance of a transmission line. So what is the role of line and ground capacitance? That is already I have discussed in the previous question. That is, there is the capacitance, that is distributed capacitance, existed in between two line conductor, and also one line conductor and ground, because capacitance is formed by separating two conducting plates. So here the line conductor acts as one conducting plate and another conductor acts as another conducting plate, and in between two conducting plates there is one dielectric, that is air medium. Similarly, ground capacitance is nothing but that is capacitance occurs between one conductor and earth. One conductor act as one conducting plate, another conducting plate is the earth, and in between two the air is the dielectric medium. Therefore the capacitance is existed throughout the transmission line, therefore it is distributed throughout the transmission line. Then in the due to this line capacitance, what happens? More charging current is available. That is, if the line capacitance is more, the charging current is more, which cancels the reactive component of load current. So the line loss reduces and efficiency increases, reduces voltage drop, voltage regulation improves, and load capacity and power factor improves. Therefore, line capacitance is very, very important, that is, which improves the parameter or the performance parameter of the transmission line. Then what is a spike? A short duration voltage surge is called generally spike. So voltage surge means what? It is also called short duration transient voltage. Generally, during lightning period or short circuit, power outages, etc., this type of voltage develop, that is short duration surge voltage, is called a spike, and it is very, very dangerous. Due to this spike, there is a chance of damaging the device. Lightning period or during short circuit period or during outages, etc. Therefore, the spike is very, very important in the power system. Then what is called Ferranti effect? When there is no load in the receiving end, that is, the receiving end current is zero. Automatically, if there is no load connected to receiving end, then the receiving end current is zero. So in case of both DC and AC lines, the charging current flowing through the series inductance of line, causing rise in output voltage of the receiving end. So this is called Ferranti effect, and this is caused due to following cause. Then we'll discuss now why this Ferranti effect occurs. A long transmission line can be considered to compose a considerable high amount of capacitance and inductance distributed across the entire length of line. Ferranti effect occurs when current drawn by the distributed capacitance of the line itself is greater than the current associated with the load at the receiving end of the line. during light or no load, this capacitor charging current leads to a voltage drop across the light inductor of the transmission system, which is in phase with sending end voltage. This voltage drop keeps on increasing additively as we move towards the load. End of the line, and subsequently the receiving end voltage tends to get larger than applied voltage, leading to the phenomena called the Ferranti effect in power system. Then what is called SIL, that is surge impedance loading. This is also another very important question. The surge impedance loading or SIL of a transmission line is nothing but the megawatt loading of a transmission line at which the natural reactive power balance occurs. It means what? It means the surge impedance loading is very essential parameter when it comes to the study of power system, as it used in the prediction of maximum loading capacity of a transmission line. It means maximum, how much we can load, that is we can given the megawatt load to a transmission line. This information we can find out from the surge impedance loading, which is very essential parameter for the transmission line. So generally, the surge impedance loading of a transmission line is the megawatt loading of a transmission line at which natural reactive power balance occurs. Means the reactive power due to distributed capacitance and distributed inductance, both are cancelled out each other. That is called the natural reactive power balance. So, this is your surge impedance, or it is called SIL. Next, what is the requirement of bundle conductor for EHV line? So, already we know that what is stranded conductor, but what is the requirement of bundle conductor for EHV lines? So bundle conductor means that is we can use more than one conductor for one phase with a definite space between two conductors, that is called bundling of conductor or bundle conductor. Then why we have designed this bundle conductor instead of composite conductor? So let us see. A voltage above 300 kilovolt causes significant power loss and interference with communication circuit. If a round single conductor per phase is used, so we are using more than one conductor per phase, called bundling of conductor. It reduces voltage gradient, corona discharge, radio interference, improves power factors, improve maximum power transfer capability. So due to these advantages, so the bundle conductors are used, that is the voltage around 400 kilovolt or more than 400 kilovolt, that is EHV, extra high voltage AC lines. So next, What is called block start capability service in power system? So block start capability for the system is ensuring the system is restored back to normal operating state in the short possible time. It means, suppose a system is failed due to some cause. Just for an example, during the super cyclone period, the entire failure of electricity in the state. Therefore, the block start capability means what? The block start capability means that ensures the restored of system as soon as possible or normal operation should be done in a shortest possible time. So this is called block start capability, and this can be done by tie line from neighboring areas or station with block start capability. It means what? It means this should be possible, or the block start capability service is possible if we'll if we'll tie line power with our neighboring areas or station with block start capability. It means, so after entire power failure in the Odisha, we can take the power from Jharkhand or West Bengal or Andhra Pradesh. Like that, that is possible by the tie line from different electricity company. So next question is, the advantage of per unit system in power system. It provides relative magnitude information. It means what? Let us see a power generating station, the different types of alternators, that is the rating, power rating, frequency rating, voltage rating are different. So due to per unit system, we can get the relative magnitude of each and every machine and each and every rating, that is voltage rating, power rating, current rating. So that information we can collect due to per unit system. So next advantage is, circuit analysis is greatly simplified. Due to per unit system, the circuit analysis is greatly simplified because it is subjected to different types of transformation. So therefore, the circuit analysis is greatly simplified by using per unit system. So next advantage is, circuit parameter changes to narrow numerical range, making the erroneous data easy to spot. It means the circuit parameters, for example, the power or voltage or per unit voltage or per unit power or per unit current, that is fall to narrow range Therefore, if there is any error, then that we can easily find out. That is, the erroneous data can easy to spot. So these are the main advantage of using Power Unity system. So next important question is, what is called control area in power system? Considering the problem of controlling the power output of generators of a closely knit electric area so as to maintain a steady frequency, all the generators speed up and slow down together, maintaining their relative power angle. Such an area defined as control area. It means what? It means, so considering the problems of controlling the power output of generators are closely knit, it means when there is change in load condition in different generators, and suddenly, it means suddenly the load increases, suddenly load decreases. So there are so many things happen in that cases. The power output of generator of closely knit electric area so as to maintain the steady frequency. All the generators speed up and slow down together, maintaining their relative power angles. So according to load changes, the power angle changes, but we have to accordingly control the power angles. So such an area defined as the control area. The boundary of control area will generally coincide with that of individual electricity board, electric city board company. So thank you very much for watching my video.